Hey, what's up? This is TJ. Thanks so much for joining me. Today we're going to be looking at generative sound design using the Arturia PolyBrute. A couple days ago, I had posted a preset on my YouTube channel here. I called it self-aware. And the idea behind it was a generative patch. All I needed to do was hit one note and it just started growing and evolving with complex soundscapes. And it was never always the same. It always kind of changed and evolved into something different as it went. And that particular video went for about 3 minutes, and each point in the video, it always has something a little bit more to offer than it did before. So one of my viewers had asked me to do a tutorial on that, and I thought that would be a fun idea. So I'm going to give a tutorial on that given patch, and I also created a couple more. And also, just for fun, I'm going to create a new one just from scratch, and we'll see where that goes. So if you like the videos that I'm doing here, you got to subscribe to this channel. You can share them too, please, and check out tjontheroad.com for more. The patches that are in this video are going to be offered soon in a complete bank of patches that I'm going to be offering on my website, so look out for that. Let's get started with the fun. All right, so the first thing you're probably asking yourself is, TJ, where the heck is your PolyBrute? Well, it's actually over there on my keyboard stand. And that's because today we're going to be using PolyBrute Connect. If you haven't been using PolyBrute Connect, I highly recommend it. It is actually, I think, much faster to use than the PolyBrute itself in order to do your sound design. I often like using it first, and then later on I'll go back to PolyBrute itself and kind of do a little bit of fine tweaking. Particularly for this type of, you know, generative type of patching, because you'll see here there are a ton of different mod matrices being used. I've used almost all of them. And so there's a lot of back and forth with that you would have to do on PolyBrute itself. And there's also a lot of menus that I've used to, create the given patches. So this happens to be a lot faster in doing that. And then, as I said, later on, I went and did a little bit of tweaking on PolyBrute itself. But today I'm going to show you it on PolyBrute Connect because it'll also be much easier for me to show you it there. Let's have a listen to that first patch, Self-Aware. Alright, self-aware as a fun patch. Let me show you how I made it. Let's take a look here at PolyBrute Connect. The first idea I had with this given patch is what I wanted to do is I wanted to change the timbre of the sound a lot. You know, give it a lot of variation in timbre and overtones and particles and so forth, partials I should say, over top of that. So let's take a look at how that was done. You'll see here I have VCO1, okay, being fed into the mixer. And VCO2 is not being fed into the mixer at all. It's not passing the mixer, I should say, into the filters. And it's turned all the way down. So the settings for VCO1 are pretty much generic. They're set for a triangle wave. The metalizer is all the way down. There's no sync. The tuning is straight up and down. Very, very generic settings. Let's take a look and see how I modulated that to make it more interesting. Going down to the modulation matrix, the first thing I said is I took the global pitch and I'm modulating that with LFO1 and a very, very small amount here. You'll see just 0.0008. LFO1 is set to a triangle wave at the slowest possible rate. The next mod slot that I used also now variated the overall tone of VCO1 by changing the mix of the sawtooth and the triangle wave here, as well as the metallizer. Now, it's negative 100% on the saw and triangle mix, and positive 100% on the metallizer. So what's happening here with LFO1 as it goes through its cycle? It's slowly going to move from triangle to a sawtooth and back. And then in the converse motion, the opposite direction, is going to slowly increase the metallizer all the way to 100% and then to back. And you'll see I have the metallizer set for always as opposed to the triangle. So what you're going to find out that's happening here is that the triangle wave doesn't have a lot of overtones associated with it, whereas the sawtooth has pretty much the maximum amount of overtones, partials that are associated with it. As it goes into the sawtooth wave, the metallizer will increase, so the overtones of the sound will increase, and the metallizer does what's called wave folding. It folds the wave over and above itself in a West Coast synthesis style. So you're going to get a lot of overtones there with that. So that's being varying the sound. Next thing I wanted to do is I wanted to change some of the sounds with the filters and vary them in cool ways. So first thing we have is the Steiner cutoff, then we have the Steiner slope, the resonance, and then the brute factor. Now, we're first looking at the cutoff, and that's being used with the VCF envelope. Now, normally you can just route the VCF amounts here, the envelope amount, to that, you know, by default. You don't necessarily need to use a mod slot for that. But since we're not actually re-triggering the keyboard here, okay, we're only going to hit it once, there's only going to be one trigger throughout this entire sound, you're going to need to route that through the modulation matrix. And it's routed to the VCF envelope here, which is set for looping. So at these settings, it's going to loop over and over and over again. All right, so with the Steiner cutoff, it's set to go in a negative direction on that loop. And then the same thing is true with the Steiner slope that's up here. The slope is low pass, high pass, and band pass. What you may not know is that between the low pass and high pass, directly in the middle, high pass is directly north, it's actually a notch filter. So it will notch throughout the frequency range as this is being modulated by, in this case, the modulation envelope over here that is also set for looping. All right, next we have the Steiner resonance, okay, and that is actually, let's see here, that is being modulated by LFO3. Let's take a look at LFO3. Well, that's a pretty generic setting right there. The curve is set directly north, the symmetry is set for directly north, and the rate is at the slowest rate possible. All right, not exactly, you know, rocket science is there. The actual wave is set to be inverted. That's something new with PolyBrute 2.0 firmware. So that's cool. But later on, what I've done, you'll see, is I'm going to be doing modulations of this modulator. All right, next is the brute factor. And that is being modulated by LFO2. LFO2 is on a sample and glide setting, so it will randomly glide through different levels of the actual distortion, actual brute factor that is within the Steiner filter. If you're not aware, the brute factor within the Steiner filter is actually a feedback loop within the filter. Next, we focus here on the ladder filter, that being the cutoff, the resonance, the distortion. Okay, and those are similarly being, you know, modified by either the modulation envelope or LFO2. All right, moving on. Okay, now what I'm doing is I'm taking the second VCO and I'm feeding it back into VCO1 to create even more temporal changes. So the first thing I did is I take the VCO pitch of VCO1, and I want to make sure that does some changes there. So that's set again to the modulation envelope. So the pitch is being varied here. It's actually going down. compared to the given rate of the modulation envelope. All right, and the next is VCO2 to VCO1. Well, that's actually the FM right here. All right, and that is actually being fed by the VCF envelope. Next, we have the pulse width of VCO2. That's being changed by LFO1. You'll see the LFO2 is set to a square wave, and the pulse width is all the way to the negative direction. Okay, so actually at that wave, at that amount, you get very little sound because the waveform is almost at full, what's called duality, I guess. But as it moves forward through that, the waveform will get wider and wider and wider, and you'll hear more and more of it. So that's why it's going into a positive direction here. All right, now next you'll see here, it says amount, right? Amount 1A6. What the heck does that mean, right? That means that we are modifying a modifier, okay, with another modulation source. All right, so what that means is A number 6. Well, A number 6 here, right, that is all the way over here, that is the Steiner cutoff. So I am going to be using LFO2, again, the random sample and glide, to further modify that cutoff. And what I'm doing by modifying the cutoff with this modifier, okay, is actually I'm increasing the amount of effect that the envelope will have on that cutoff. All right, next is the master cutoff over here. Right here, that's that mod slot here. And that's being affected by LFO3. Moving forward a little faster, I've set LFO3 for the curve, the symmetry, and the rate. The curve, the symmetry, and the rate. Now this is where I'm modulating the modulator per se, and that I'm using again the VCF envelope to change the curve back and forth like that, and also the symmetry of it back and forth like that. And then the rate is actually being changed again on a random basis with LFO2 through the sample and glide setting, so that the rate actually increases and decreases, you know, a little bit as that slowly moves through that randomization. All right, next I played around with the effects. Let's take a look at the effects that I used. I used the assemble effect. Again, that's the new effect in the PolyBrute 2.0 firmware. I love the way that sounds. That's possibly my greatest new effect here. I EQ boosted the low end. Again, that's a new effect within the 2.0 firmware. And what I'm doing here with the modulations is, let's see, I am actually affecting the delay time of the delay. Right? And again, I'm using LFO3 for that. Because if you look at the delay here, it's a long delay. Right? It's just basically a very basic sound. There's not really much going to be happening there if it just stays at that. I wanted to get that a little bit of modulation back and forth, okay, to really kind of open up the long tails that you're hearing. So that's being done through LFO3. Again, it's being modulated in other ways, so you kind of get the idea here. You're modulating different modulators to create an ever-evolving sound. And then on the reverb, I have the dreamy reverb. All right, just to give it a lot of air. Air. All right, now, next I am modulating the modulators again, okay? I'm doing that with the mod envelope attack right here. The decay and the sustain. All right, attack, decay, sustain, as well as the VCF up here, envelope with the attack and sustain. Okay, and those are being modulated with LFO1 and LFO2. Now we get to the real fun part. You'll see here, the next destination is the morph over here, right? Let's bring this up here so you can take a look at all of the different modulation destinations here. Now, I've used the triangle wave in LFO1, okay, to modulate the morph. So it's going to self-move from A to B within PolyBrute. So slowly, you're going to see all of these destinations change their value as it goes to B, and then as it goes back. So many of those destinations are changing their value. And that's happening automatically through the triangle wave that's at the slow rate on LFO1. So morphing is the most powerful thing, I think, within the PolyBrute, and the fact that you can use it as a destination is super cool. Alright, lastly, I kind of mess with the rate of the LFO. I feedbacked it on itself from LFO2 over here. Okay. Alright, and the global panning. Alright, and let's see, last year, the modulation envelope, I used a destination for that. Let's see, D8. Alright, I used LFO1 to kind of mess with the amount of that modulation. Very fun. Now the next preset we're going to look at is something I call Fellowship Ring. Obviously an ode to the Lord of the Rings, the geek that I am, and it also has a reference to the ring modulator within the PolyBrute. Let's give a listen to it. That's what's called Fellowship Ring. Obviously a ambient type of sound, something spacey, something pad-like. Not nearly as complex as the self-aware sound that we were talking about before. And it's not nearly as complex in its design. Something that you might hear in a movie, you know, like before the scene where all the aliens come and eat everybody, you know. That's the type of sound that I was looking for. Let's take a look at the sound here, right, on PolyBrute Connect. Now with this, I wanted to do something with the effects first. I like to start at different modules within the synthesizer. Don't always start with the oscillator, say, for example. I like to start at different points. I like to start with the envelopes, say, for example, or the LFOs, or the filters, and so forth. In this case, I started with the ring modulator. And yeah, I have the ring modulation maxed out all the way. Now normally when you do that, it's a pretty nasty sound, right? Not very, very pleasing. So I want to see if I can find a way to make that a pleasing kind of sound. So I took that with the delays, I maxed those out in terms of the level with a long delay, and I maxed the reverb out to get a little long, you know, tail, you know, type of reverbing effect type sound. PolyBrute really lets you do that. I want to take full advantage of that. I also use the EQ settings to max the presence of the sound. So it would have, you know, a nice mid-range boost presence in there, and it wouldn't have a lot of low end. So let's take a look at what else I did within the modulation matrix. The static settings are with VCO1. I had to set the metalizer all the way down, sawtooth, wave here. I have it synced from oscillator 2 into 1. Okay. And you'll see it with VCO2, okay, I have it set so it's at a fifth all the way up. 770 tones would be a fifth over and above that. All right, I had the sub all the way down. The FM's all the way down. It's also on a sawtooth. Looking into the modulation metrics, the first thing that I did, okay, in here, let's bring that up, is I assigned the pitch to LFO2. Just again, as I did before with the earlier preset, just a little bit to get a little bit of variance. And again, LFO2 is set to the sample and glide setting. I really do like that for this type of generative patching. and is at a moderately slow rate. Next, we have the Steiner cutoff. That's being assigned to LFO1 here. Okay, and LFO1 is just on a simple sine wave. Again, I just want like a very slow type of evolving type of sound here. Nothing too shocking, but the sine wave is at a moderate, roughly two-thirds rate. All right, moving on, we have the noise right here that's going into VCF2, the noise into VCF2 here. Okay, that's being increased by the VCF envelope. Okay, now instead of it looping, I just have it on the single. Okay, so when I hit the preset, it's just going to evolve once over the time that it's being held. Okay, now on all these presets, you're going to want to go to the whole function here. I should have mentioned that before, the whole function. So you're just holding the note, it's holding the whole time. So in the case of both the noise into VCF2 and the sub from VCF1 up here, all right, those are being controlled by the VCF envelope up here. So it's going to have a very long attack, a little bit of decay to a low amount. Okay. And then it's going to just hold as long as you again have those notes held. All right, let's go. Next, we're modulating the modulation envelope attack here. All right, and that's being done with velocity. So the harder I'm going to hit the note, the more change it's going to have. So this gives a little bit of variance every time I try to play the sound. And here we have LFO3. It is affecting the metallizer, the ladder distortion, the overall noise level here, and the rate of LFO3. So it's modulating itself. Looking at LFO3, while the curve is set to one side, the symmetry is in the center, and the rate is relatively low. So when we're modulating that by itself with LFO3 rate, by LFO3, as LFO3 is the destination, it's going to actually, you know, bump up and increase a little bit with the given curve here. And the next things I changed were the delay time with the randomness of LFO2, the color of the noise from going pure white noise all the way over here to a more filtered noise color. And let's see what else we have. The symmetry is also being modified in a random way from LFO2. And then the global panning is also being modified by both LFO2 and LFO3. And lastly, the reverb time is having a slight bit of modulation there. Okay, the next preset I want to show you is called Tickles. A lot of fun. Let's hear it. Tickles is a fun preset. It's actually not that complicated, so we're going to run through it really, really quickly. The first thing that I did with the preset is I used the new PolyBrute 2.0 firmware chord function. You do that by hitting and holding the polyphony button on the PolyBrute itself, and then you play whatever chord it is that you want to play. So in this case, I believe I play just, you know, a fifth. Just to give it a nice overall tonality, and that's another way to capture some additional sounds with it. Let's go into the settings of the different modules here. VCO1 here, the metallizer's nearly straight north here. It's set on a triangle wave. It's also set to only be on the triangle wave. There's no sync. It's octave fifths. This is important later on. You'll find out as that gets modulated, it's going to go through those octave fifths in terms of when it pans all the way through the different tunings. And again, down here in VCS2, it's also octafis, okay? And you'll see the tuning is actually tuned up a full octave because it's set to 12 semitones and it's tuned up to the full octave. Here it's set to the sawtooth, okay? The mixer here has, you know, roughly 75% there, okay? Let's look into the modulation matrix and see what we've got going on here. All right, first is LFO2 is adding some vibrato on itself, right there. And LFO2 is my favorite sample and glide. All right, and then we're adding a little bit of variance to the overall level with the VCA as a destination, and that's being done with the mod envelope. Let's look at the mod envelope. It is looping with some pretty long times associated with that. Next is the pitch of VCO1 that is being modulated with VCF envelope up here. Again, that's also looping with very long times associated with it. And now, okay, I was going to use the morph here, which I did with LFO 3. Okay, so again, this is one of those patches where it morphs on its own back and forth. So if I go here, you can see that the amounts are going to be changing just on some things as it automatically morphs from A to B, from the A preset to the B preset. And with LFO 3 up here, the curve is set all the way to one side, the symmetry is set slightly off, and the rate is roughly at 3/4. Now, one other thing here is that you'll see that the LFO 1, 2, and 3 are all synced together. All right, so that's very, very important, as well as you'll see in this particular preset that the delay is also synced. All right, now if we look into that, it's synced binarily, so it's not like a triplet or a dotted amount. And it's, but it is a dotted amount on the delay. So that all adds up to something interesting, I think. The pitch of VCF2, again, like I said, was modulated with LFO2. That is the sample and glide. The FX modulation intensity, well, again, I'm using the ring mod here. In this case, it's not set so high, so it's giving you more or less a panning type of effect. And now, let's see what else we got going on here. VCF2 sub, that's over here. Okay, that's being modulated with the modulation envelope, so you're going to hear more and more of that bass, you know, coming up and going down on a random amount because it's being modulated with LFO2. And the metalizer up here, okay, it's being modulated with the modulation envelope. The VCO2, the VCF1, that is the FM here. All right, that's over here. And that is using LFO3 to modulate that. All right, now, LFO2 is modulating the symmetry of LFO3. Again, on a random basis, LFO3 is modulating the noise level overall, that's over here. All right, LFO1 is modulating the master cutoff. And the color of the noise, here is all the way to white with the LFO1. All right, that is set to a sample and hold rate, a sample and hold wave, excuse me. All right, that's set to a negative, so it's going to negatively change from a full white noise to a more filtered noise. And the rate of LFO3, again, is being feeded back upon itself by its source of modulation, that being LFO3. All right, and that's it for that given sound. All right, so next we're going to take a look at a brand new default sound that we're going to create into something magical, or at least I hope it's magical. But really the idea is just to give you, you know, a pathway of my thinking into creating some generative sounds. So let's get under the hood and give it a shot. All right, let's look at here. The first thing we want to do, go back to that. We want to hit hold here. All right, because we just want one trigger, one keyboard setting. We're going to make a chord here. You can do this with chord mode, but I'm just going to do it right here. A lovely little quart. Let's see what we can do with it. You can start anywhere here. I'm going to start with the filters. Alright, now I'm going to make sure that they're panned to that. Okay, alright, I'm going to put these in series. That being the Steiner filter is now feeding into the ladder filter. I'm going to turn this all the way up. Alright, go to the matrix. And we're going to make the filter cut off of the Steiner filter a destination. And I don't know, what are we going to do with that? Let's see. How about we make a looping envelope with the VCF envelope. And we're going to make it asymmetrical. So let's see, something like that. All right. So now we're going to modify that. Alright, that's interesting. Why don't we make it into a bandpass filter though? And we'll find a sweet spot for it. Okay. Now you don't always have to use just one of that. I kind of like it where it sweeps through that setting. So I'm also going to use LFO1, just have it sweep through there. Alright, now LFO1 is a little bit of a fast rate. I like the sine wave for this. I'm going to slow it down just a little bit. Alright, I'm going to feed it back on itself. Alright, so the rate of LFO1. The LFO itself is going to affect its own rate. Alright. That sounds like fun. Alright, let's look at the ladder filter. I'm going to bring the cutoff down on that. Now you might think, oh, well, that's too much. Well, it probably is, but let's assign that to 2. Okay, let's see, the cutoff, okay, and I want to assign that to 2. Okay, kind of like that. All right, let's get some of the resonance up on some of these. Okay, that's very Pete Townsend-ish from The Who. Very cool. Let's see here. My next destination. Let's see. Let's go and mess with the sound here. How about the metalizer? Alright. And we're going to raise that up here. And again, I'm going to use 2 for that. I see it's only set to triangle. Okay. But I'm also going to use this, that being the mix from the sawtooth to the triangle. And I'm going to use number 2 so it blends into both of them. Okay, that's kind of interesting. Let me back this down just a little bit. There we go. Alright, so where else are we going to do? How about we try the master cutoff? Let's see what happens when we move this around here. Alright, I'm going to loop the mod envelope. I'm going to make it a very long loop. Alright. And I'm going to use the mod envelope. to modify the master cutoff. Started at a slow. Started at a slightly down amount. Okay. And I'm going to change the amount of the decay and delay as destinations with, oh, let's say we'll use LFO2 for that. All right, I'm going to play around with a little bit. Try to get a little bit brighter. There we go. That way it occupies a nice range. Raise the distortion here. Okay, that's kind of fun. Let's change the sound of this to a square wave. Alright. I'm going to use the mod envelope for that. And give it some pulse width modulation with LFO1. Alright, so now the mod envelope is changing it from a sawtooth to a square wave, and the square wave is getting pulse width modulation. So that's panning back and forth from that. Alright, what else are we going to do? We have a chord here, so we want to make it bigger. Adding, give it a little pan spread. Change the analog accuracy. Make it wild. And that's kind of the idea. I could go on and on and on for another hour or two for this, but let's just add some effects and see how it sounds. I think this is begging for a phaser. All right. Let me cue. Now, how about some presence? That works. There we go. Some stereo. Delay. Maybe some springy reverb. Alright, well that's it. That's the idea. You know, take it, use the modulation matrix to just continually change things, create feedback loops to create more and more and more variety. I mean, we only used half of the modulation matrix. We can go even further. There's other things on the PolyBrute that you can also use, okay? We didn't even touch the motion recorder, say, for example. You can certainly use that in a loop and create that, you know, more and more of a modulation. So that's a lot of fun. There's a lot more that you can do, obviously. I want to thank you so much for watching the video. I want to thank Arturia also for coming out with the PolyBrute and the 2.0 firmware. I really think that is awesome. If you like what I'm doing here, please do share and subscribe the video. The presets that I am working on are going to come out soon in a whole pack of new presets, including Generative and other types of presets. So I'm looking forward to that. Hit the bell. You'll see, you know, when new videos come out. That show you that coming, as well as check out tjontheroad.com for more. Thanks so much again, and I will see you next time. Let's see what else we can do with this.